notes for tonight. We are in Hebrews chapter 5, and you can see the subtitle. Can anybody say that name? I put the pronunciation there for you. I did that on purpose, make it easy for you. I really don't care how you say it. You can say Melchizedek. I'm fine with that. Let's call him Melchizedek now. We've heard about him, right? You've heard about him. If you've been in church a couple times, you've heard about Melchizedek. All right, Melchizedek. Melchizedek, his name means King of Righteousness. We're going to talk about him because in Hebrews chapter 5, it finally mentions him. And Hebrews is the only book in the New Testament that does mention him. It mentions him several times. Other than that, it's interesting, a character like this, he's only mentioned one. There's only one account in the Bible that talks about him in Genesis. You guys know it, we'll talk about it. Only one time. Mentioned in the Psalms and then here in Hebrews. But there's so much here. So let's see. I believe that God wants us to see Scripture at this time. He wants us to read it and see it through a new lens, right? And you know we've been experiencing that. You read it through a different lens with different understanding. I put the verse there ahead of Matthew, ahead of Hebrews 5, Matthew 6:22. Maybe you've heard this verse. It says, "The light of the body is the eye." You ever hear that? "If therefore thine eye be single, the whole body shall be full of light." And God, the lens that God wants us to look through is that single eye. You ever hear about the single eye? You know, all human beings, we have two eyes, right? But the Bible talks about the single eye. Really what it is, it's the union of the duality that's inside of us, inside of the world, and it's creating the one out of the two. And the Bible talks about that all throughout, where he brings reconciliation, he makes the two one. And that's the place where we need to see from. It's the place of union, it's the place of a oneness with God. Some people refer to the single eye as the third eye. It's because it's not as if you lose one of your eyes. It's as if you put both of the eyes together. There's a certain union, a harmony, a balance, right? And then you start to see life differently. Amen? You know, the duality that God wants to take us from, he wants to take us from our duality into our singleness. And the duality, it's the duality of thinking. It exists in the world. It exists in our lives. It's duality of having to judge whether something is good or evil. He wants to take us to a higher place than that. It's the duality of us even describing people as believers or unbelievers. God says there's something so much greater. There's actually a unity of that. There's not a separation. There's the believer and the unbeliever resides inside every one of us. There's a oneness in that. And I praise the Lord, he's taken us from old thinking, like the believer goes to heaven and the unbeliever goes to hell. That's just old thinking. It's thinking with duality, with two eyes. It's seeing with two eyes and thinking with duality that always separates. What do we do? What do we do in our duality and in our humanness? We always separate. You're bad, you're good. You're heaven, you're hell. You're God, you're the devil. And that's sin. Sin is always separating. And the cross and reconciliation, what is it always doing? It's always reuniting, right? Bringing back together. That's the work of the cross. Isn't that interesting? So God wants to take us from this dualistic thinking, and because our dualistic thinking brings us into dualistic living. We see human or divine. We see heaven or earth. We see black or white. And God says, you know, we see day or night. God says, I'm both. I'm both day and night. I'm both black and white. We always like to have definitive terms. Us human beings, we like to have concrete answers and conclusions and closures, but God doesn't operate that way. He doesn't. He always leaves you out there. Listen, we want to be in control of everything. God will bring us to a place in the singleness of I, you're in control of nothing and like it. there's beauty, there's strength. It's a larger life. Isn't it a larger life? When you're in control of your own puny life, I don't want to denigrate anybody. It's a small life. It's a life of constraints. It's a life of fear. It's a life of anxiety, right? You know that. Every one of us in this room knows that, because we all try to control people and things and situations. And when you do that, you're always anxious, right? There's no peace there. So God wants to bring us, and he wants to bring us to a greater place. It's seeing through a different lens, seeing Scripture through a different lens. It's a beautiful thing. So I don't know. I don't want to read the whole thing here. Hebrews chapter 5. Let's read a little. I'm going to read, okay? Let's read a little bit together. Let's see how it starts. It says this. It says, every high priest selected to represent men and women before God and offer sacrifices for their sins should be able to deal gently with their failings, since he knows what it's like from his own experience. But that also means that he has to offer gifts and sacrifices for his own sins as well as the people's. This is before Christ came along. No one elects himself to this honored position. He's called by God, as Aaron was. Neither did Christ presume to set himself up as high priest, but was set apart by the one who said to him, yes, you are my son, today I celebrate you. In another place, God declares, you are a priest forever in the royal order of, what's that word? Melchizedek. You don't want to say it the other way? Melchizedek. Okay, first time in the New Testament that name is mentioned, Melchizedek. Let's see. Let's go down to verse 11. Well, you see, after he talks about Melchizedek, the writer says, I have a lot more to say about this, about Melchizedek. I have a lot more to say about this. But it is hard to get it across to you since you've picked up this bad habit of... That's funny. I love that. You've picked up this bad habit of not listening. We're mostly talkers. We're not mostly listeners. Most of the times it looks like people are listening. They're really not. They're just preparing their thoughts so they can talk. You ever notice that about yourself or someone else? Have you ever noticed that about yourself? You ever been in a conversation or an argument or a debate? You're really not listening to the other person. You can't have a debate if you don't have ears open and you're not receptive to new ideas. And most of the times we human beings are not. I'm not receptive to your idea how to organize this. I know how to organize this. I'll pretend like I'm listening to you. So we're going to do it my way, right? And God says here, though the writer here says, God says, I'd like to take you past your sticking point, but you're in this bad habit of not listening. So true. We know what we know at times and with certain things. We know what we know, and you can't change that. God is bringing us to a place where you have to be susceptible to change in every area of your life. For growth. And we all want to grow, but growth is an uncomfortable process. Right? I love that. God wants to, and that place of listening, I have to pause here, because that place of listening, that's the place where God's been calling us to. It's this place really called prayer. Prayer is not us rattling off a bunch of requests. That's silliness. Prayer is us listening, meditating, asking God to come into our minds, our worlds, and perhaps change them. Right? Us coming to God saying, thinking, you know, in our old self we know everything, but coming to God in a new way, say, God, how about this? I know nothing. Don't you love that? God's bringing us to that place. You go before God, or go before people, go before anyone with an open mind. We're so stubborn and selfish and really ignorant and proud because we think we know everything. We don't listen to people. We don't listen to each other. All we do is declare ourselves. Isn't that true? Can anybody? We just declare ourselves for the most part. What I know, who I know, what I did, why I'm important. And it's okay because I think at the bottom line of all that is we just want to be liked and loved, right? Until we discover, we love you, no matter what you think you know or how important you think you are. But this listening here is God asking you, why don't you go take a chair, go sit down someplace, and just let God talk to you. Maybe present him with a question. You know, God likes questions. When you don't have questions, it means you don't care. And I'm not saying, don't ask him the question, God, should I get a red car or a blue car? God, should I get this house or this house? Should I get this? Stop. How about ask him about him instead of yourself? Ask him about him. God, what do you think about this? What does this mean? What, right? Read a passage in Scripture and say, Lord, what does that mean? Do you know he'll tell you? Do you care? If you don't ask questions, the truth is, if you don't ask questions, it's because you don't care. Never mind, I can go on and on, but I won't, because it'll be abusive. But God says, I'd like to bring you into greater things, but we have this habit of not listening. And you know, on a Wednesday night, this does not pertain to you. Because very few come out on Wednesday night. This does not pertain. I always do this as a precursor. I am preaching to everybody who is not in this room. I tell you. Like, I am preaching to the choir here. Well, yeah, for the most part, yes. Right? You don't have to be here. Right? Okay. So he says, you have this bad habit of not listening. By this time, you ought to be teachers. Yet I find that you need someone to sit down and actually teach you the basics again. I'm going to talk about that a little bit. Okay, let's talk about Melchizedek. Actually, in Hebrews 7, which we're going to read in a few weeks, verses 1 through 3, that really is the best passage in Scripture that tells us who Melchizedek is. So, Pastor Dad, would you read that? That's not even the Message Bible. That's like the NIV. You might enjoy that. Okay, Pop, what does that say? Okay, this is a great passage here. This tells you everything that the Bible tells you about Melchizedek. Number one, his name means King of Righteousness, but he was the King of Salem, otherwise known as Jerusalem. He was King of Jerusalem, because it goes on to say that King of Salem means King of Peace. All right, so he was the King of Righteousness, he was the King of Peace, Melchizedek. I like the fact that it talks about his high priesthood here. It says he was priest of God Most High. I think God wants us to understand that aspect tonight. What does that mean to be God Most High, the Most High God? He was God of the Most High, and I think there's purpose in that. Not just God, not just High God, but Most High God. I think God was opening that up to us. Let's see. The interesting thing is, it says he has no beginning, he has no ending, right? You ever hear about that? When some people ask you, like, who's the oldest guy in the Bible, what do you usually say? Methuselah, right? Actually, Melchizedek is older than Methuselah, because he has no beginning, he's eternal. So Melchizedek really is the oldest guy in the Bible. He says he has no father or mother. I think what it's saying is there's nothing natural about this man. This is absolutely supernatural here. But I thought maybe we'd see some pictures tonight. Let's take a look at a couple of these pictures. What do you got for us, Brother Keith? And then we'll go from there. Remember when we did the study of the tabernacle? The tabernacle is a three-room house, right? God lives in a three-room house. You know that, right? The tabernacle, the temple, it's made up of three rooms. God lives in a three-room house. It's the outer court, the inner court, and the holy place. Or it's called, really, the inner court is called the holy place. There on the heading it says holy and most holy place. Yet the holy and most holy place. Can you see the most holy place? Is they opened up the curtain for us so we can see the Ark of the Covenant. You see the Ark of the Covenant? So the curtains there were usually closed. They weren't open. As a matter of fact, you couldn't open them like that. But there was a curtain, and then beyond the curtain was the Ark of the Covenant, and that's called the most holy place. But prior to that was called the holy place. Remember what was in the holy place? Yeah, the lampstand, you see it there? The table of showbread, the altar of incense, right? And there was still one more. I tell you what, could you show us the other picture, brother? That was only two rooms. Actually, there's three rooms to God's house. God lives in a three-room house. Remember the outer court? So you had the outer court, the holy place, and the most holy, right? And you remember on the outer court, there were two pieces of furniture on the outer court. You had the altar and the laver, right? And then you go inside, you have the other pieces, right? Mm-hmm. Now, when Melchizedek is referred to as God of the Most High, I think it's telling us that he's God from the innermost place. God wants to tell us something about the most holy place. The Most High God is from the most holy place. And I think that this is the place where Melchizedek lives and dwells, and what God wants to open up to us. He wants to give us an understanding that there's a greater realm that he wants us to walk in, and that's the most holy place. It's the third realm. Now, the third realm is what we mentioned when we started the service. The third realm is the single eye, or the third eye, if you will. Because God wants to, first you see God in a natural way in the outer court, right? And then you see God in the spiritual way in the inner court. But then God wants you to somehow unify the natural and the spiritual world and create one world out of the two and create that most holy place, you know? Like God wants to somehow unify your natural man and your spirit man, you know, and bring you into an absolute oneness. Like sometimes, you know, when God brings us into the spirit realm, sometimes we have a habit of trying to have dividing lines between a carnal realm and a spiritual realm, as if one realm is good and one realm is bad. We have a human nature and a divine nature. God wants us somehow to reconcile our two natures, you know? Not to reject our natural man or our natural life, but also not to reject our spiritual life, you know? Like God doesn't want us to be so occupied with our natural life, just living a natural life, you know, acquiring whatever goods and success you can have in this natural world. That's not what our life should be about. But neither should it be about us thinking, oh, I can't wait till I get out of this place, because then I'm going home, as if this is not home. And I know, you know, at certain troubled times, we like to comfort one another by saying, oh, they went home, as if this is not home. We're just sojourners, pilgrims. But God's not really talking about the earth. He's not even talking about your natural life, as if your natural life has no importance. Because you know what we've always said, if your natural life means nothing, why doesn't God just kill us all or take us all if it doesn't mean anything? Like if we're all just waiting to go home, right? Like there's absolute importance to this life. There's importance to a natural life, and there's importance to a spiritual life. And God doesn't want you to reject one. He wants you to combine the two. Like Jesus Christ, he was both natural and divine. He was both human and divine. And he wants you to combine your two worlds. And that's what heaven is. The most holy place. Heaven is a balance of life. It's balancing your human with your divine, your weakness with your strength. Right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, in this passage here, I wanted to turn to another passage. I wanted to look at those pictures and somehow get a head start on where God's taking us. He's taking us to the most holy place. He wants us to see something there. I put in your commentary Genesis 14. You all got it there? This is the first time in Scripture that Melchizedek is mentioned. There's a whole chapter here about Abraham and Melchizedek. And at the beginning of the chapter, it talks about a war that went on between four kings and five kings. It was a monster war. It was like a world war, if you will. It was nations against nations. It's the first war recorded in the Bible. It's in Genesis 14, the first war recorded in the Bible, and it's a big one. So, and Melchizedek is introduced in this big war. So let's read it. As we read it, you might remember the story. I'm going to read through it. Why don't you read it along with me? At this time, Amraphel, king of Shinar, and three other kings went to war against Bera, king of Sodom, and Bersha, king of Gomorrah, and three other kings. All these latter kings joined forces at the Salt Sea. It would be this big war, world war. It says in verse 4, for 12 years they had been subject to the king of Elam. But in the 13th year, they rebelled. In the 14th year, Kedorlaomer and the kings allied with him went out and defeated the Rephaites, the Zuzites, the Elamites, and the Horites in the hill country of Seir. Then they turned back and went to Kadesh, and they conquered the whole territory of the Amalekites and the Amorites. Okay, guys. Sodom and Gomorrah and a few other nations were subjected to this king for 12 years. They had to pay him tribute. In the 13th year, they rebelled. They say, we're not paying tribute to you anymore. We're tired of living under your rule. So in the 14th year, this king got four of his buddies, went to war against them. Five kings against four kings, right? That's what we're reading so far. But as these five kings were going towards them to reclaim them, it says that they conquered every nation in their path on the way down there. Like, these guys were monsters. That's why this is the first world war. They conquered like four, five, six really huge nations filled with giants just on their way. They were doing this for kicks just on their way to Sodom and Gomorrah. Just warming up. Destroyed everything in their path. And then by the time they got to these guys that said, we don't want to live under your rule no more, they smashed them to nothing. Conquered them entirely. And then took them all off as slaves. And you remember who was mixed up with this group? Oh, you guys know the story. That's cool, man. Lot, because where did Lot live? Yeah, he lived in Sodom and Gomorrah. So if Lot got mixed up with this, guess who's going to come and save Lot? His uncle. His uncle ain't going to have this. But what can he do? He's one man. These are warring nations. You guys know the story. I'm just having fun with you. What can Abraham do? Well, he had a couple of buddies himself. He had like three or four king friends himself. And he said, why don't you come with me and let's read the story. Okay. So the king of Sodom and the king of Gomorrah, they marched out and they drew up battle lines in the valley of Shittim against that guy, that's a tough name, Kedorlaomer, king of Elam, and the four kings. There were four kings against five kings here. Now the valley of Shittim was full of tar pits. And when the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled, some of them fell into them and the rest of them fled to the hills. Sodom and Gomorrah, these guys that rebelled, man, they had all kinds of problems, man. They were weak. They were inferior. They fell in all of these slime pits. I guess the slime pits slew them more than the other army did. And the rest got scared and ran into the mountains. So this was a real embarrassment, right? All right. The four kings seized all the goods of Sodom and Gomorrah, all of their food, and they went away. They also carried off. Who did they carry off? That was their mistake. They carried off Abraham's nephew Lot and his possessions, since he was living in Sodom. But, you know, as the stories go, as a real good story goes, like if you're going to kill a whole bunch of people, always make sure one remains, right? Because they got to tell the story. Like, what good is a great defeat if no one's alive to tell the story? So, so for the story, the sake of telling a good story, what does it say in verse 13? It says, one had escaped and came and reported it to Abraham, the Hebrew. Now, Abram was living near the great trees of Mamre, the Amorite, a brother of Eshcol and Aner, all of whom were allied with Abraham. Abraham had some buddies himself. So Abraham heard that his relative had been taken captive. He called out, you guys know this story, 318 trained men boarded in his house. Only 318 trained men boarded in his house. And they went out in pursuit as far as Dan. During the night, Abraham divided his men. He attacked them. He routed them. He chased them all the way north. Damascus and Dan, he chased them. He recovered all the goods. He brought back, who did he bring back? He got his nephew. Said, I'll take that. Thank you very much. He brought back Lot. He got everything back. And he got more than that. He took their possessions too. He got Lot, possessions, together with women, all the people that they took. Now, Melchizedek, okay? Abraham returned from defeating Kedorlaomer and the kings allied with him. The king of Sodom came out to give him respect, you know? He came out to meet him in the king's valley. But it also says, then Melchizedek, king of Salem, interesting. He brought out, what did he bring out? You know the story, bread and the wine. And he was priest of God Most High. Uh-huh. And blessed Abraham saying, Abram. Blessed, because he wasn't Abraham yet, he didn't have his children. He blessed Abram saying, blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. Take note of these words. And blessed be God Most High who delivered your enemies into your hand. Then Abram gave him a tenth of everything. And the king of Sodom said to Abram, remember he said, give me the people and keep the goods for yourself. But Abram said to the king of Sodom, I have raised my hand to the Lord. It seemed like he took hold of Melchizedek's God right here, because now he's calling him, I have raised my hand. I've come into allegiance and alliance with Melchizedek, because I raised my hand to God who? Creator of? Well, that was Melchizedek's God. Now it's Abraham's God. Looks like Abraham's got a new God. Same God, but a new God. Right? Same God, but a new God. That's what we have. Same God, but a new God. Because we see our God in a greater way. Same God, but he's a new God. He's greater. He's bigger. He's stronger. Right? That's life. We get a bigger God. Mm-hmm. And Abraham said, I'll take that bigger God. And he said to Sodom, what did he say, the king of Sodom? He said, I won't take anything from you. Why? You can't say you made me rich. All right? I swear to God Most High. So this is where Melchizedek is introduced. This is the story of us right now, what God is saying to us right now. It says, as far as Sodom and Gomorrah and those other kings, it says, for 12 years, they were subjected to King of Elam. In the 13th year, they rebelled. 14th year, a new thing happened. 12 is the number of government, you know that? You do now. 13 is the number of rebellion, you know that? You know that now. And 14 is just symbolic of a new order that's going to be represented. Something about this rebellion. You know, God wants us to rebel against certain things. There's some things that you've been a slave to. 12 years is like you've been a slave to a certain government, a certain order, a certain system, a certain thing, a certain way of living, a certain way of thinking, and you think it's the only way of thinking. You think your way of thinking is the only way of thinking, like you're the only clear thinker in the room. At times. I'm the only guy that knows what's going on. Don't you think that sometimes? Good, I'm glad you're honest. That's great. I mean, by and large, we think we're the ones who know. Everybody else needs to be taught. But 12 is the number of government, but 13 is the number of rebellion. God wants you to rebel against some things. He wants you to rise up in rebellion against something, a way of living that you've entrusted. Not necessarily bad, actually good. God wants you to rebel against it and say, I'm not living that way no more. I'm not thinking that way no more. I'm not talking that way anymore. I'm not gonna live like that anymore. I'm not gonna live angry. I'm not gonna live controlling. I'm not gonna live always fighting. I'm not gonna live that way anymore. I believe that God wants you to break out of certain ways of living and thinking and being. He wants you to rebel. I think God wants us to rebel against certain religious orders and systems. I think God wants you to actually uprise and rebel.
Amen.
Yeah, that's right. Amen. To say, that's my religion, that's my tradition, but no more. Amen. Yeah. It's like we talked about last week. There's certain things you've been raised up with, but then the prophets come along to challenge it, to critique it. And like, God wants you to start to critique the way you live and critique the way you think and critique what you believe in. And we talked about that today, Eddie. Yeah, right. You have to critique yourself. And that's a good place to be, because sometimes you don't like it when someone else comes to critique you. You don't like it when someone wants to challenge your religion. Okay, fine. Then don't let it come to that. Don't let it come to that. Why don't you challenge your religion? If you don't like someone to judge the way you think, why don't you judge the way you think? Why don't you sit down with a chair someplace and say, well, maybe I think wrong. Maybe I don't see correctly. Maybe my perspective is not the correct perspective. Maybe that person over there who I absolutely hate, maybe they have the right perspective. Now, I know those are strong words, but it's just kind of how we live anyway. Maybe that person that I can't stand actually has the right perspective on this. Maybe I don't know. And maybe certitude is not a place that God is bringing us to, but he wants us to live in the mystery. He doesn't want you to figure everything out, be in control. God does not want you to be in control of anything. And he'll get us there because he loves us. But he says, why don't you do it yourself? Why don't you rebel? Now, God doesn't say that. Yeah, he does. Why don't you rebel against certain orders? Systems and thinkings and believings and living. You know what happens when you rebel? The guys who you're rebelling against, they ain't gonna have it. They're gonna go to war. The interesting thing is when the five kings went to bring them back into subjection again, on the way there, they slaughtered all kinds of nations. You know who they slaughtered? All the giants, the Rephaimites, the Amorites. They were the giants of the land. They went through killing all the giants. And then, when Abraham heard about it, you know where Abraham was living? He was also living in the land of giants. You read those names there. Those are the lands of the giants. It says, Mamre, the Amorite. The Amorites were giants. And Aner, they were giants. Remember that Abraham was also a giant slayer. Do you know that? Abraham was also a giant slayer. As a matter of fact, where Abraham lived, it was called the gateway to paradise, the gateway to Eden. They believed that that was the actual gate back into Eden where Abraham lived. Because the garden or paradise was supposed to be that Salem place, Jerusalem place where Melchizedek came from. And Abraham was right at the gate. But to get there, he had to destroy some giants. Abraham was also a giant slayer. And I think what God is saying here is, it's time to move, like Pastor Phil said on Sunday. And he says there's something greater than the worry of giant slayers. Because these guys that were going back to get their subjects, they were warrior giant slayers. But God says they're not the most powerful people on earth. You know who's the most powerful person on earth? I'm going to tell you. Melchizedek. Melchizedek was the most powerful man on earth at that time. Melchizedek was the most powerful. You notice no one ever touched him? You probably had the swarm of armies going all around and back and forth, killing each other. Melchizedek is just there with his bread and wine. When Abraham called, "Oh, Abraham, I have some bread and wine for you." Right? The most powerful man on earth at that time was Melchizedek. Not the warrior giant slayers. Now, Abraham at this time was a warrior giant slayer. But there was somebody more powerful. You and I, God wants you and I to come to a place where we're warrior giant slayers. I think that's the holy place. The holy place. But he wants to bring us into the most holy place because he's the God Most High. There is a time and a place for your 12 years of subjection in the holy place as being a warrior giant slayer. There's a time in your life where you have to fight. But there's a time when your fighting comes to an end. And God says, "I don't want you to be a giant slayer anymore." Because he says, "Haven't you slayed them all already?" He says, "You slayed them all already." He says, "I now want you to come into the order of Melchizedek, God of the Most High, King of Peace." He says, "The Prince of Peace is greater than the warrior, giant slayer." And Melchizedek comes at the end of the battle. I believe the one who escaped is the Christ man that escaped to go and tell Abraham. The Christ man escaped, went to go and tell Abraham. The Christ went to tell Abraham. Abraham, it's time to move. We got to move from this place of the giants, this gateway to Jerusalem. The one escaped and saying, all this that's going on, there's great wars that's going on. It's because you have to move. It's time to move into Jerusalem. It's time to move and come into oneness with Melchizedek, where his God becomes your God. His God was the God Most High. And he says, "Let his God be your God." And that's exactly what happened, because later Abraham said, "I raised my hand as an oath to God Most High, creator of heaven and earth." Not just heaven, not just earth, but a combination of them both. There's a certain oneness here. I don't think I want to get into that right now. But anyway.